Welcome back. Have you ever thought what it would take to take a cold murder case from nothing, literally from a folder in somebody's desk, and take it out on the street and figure out how to solve that crime? Yeah, me either. But our next guest has, and not only that, she has gotten so close to the crime that it makes her a little bit scary in her own way, too. Let me welcome and introduce you to Ana Garcia. Ana, thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you, Lauren, although scary,
well,
I don't
know. You know what? I have to tell you that going from being an Emmy Award-winning broadcast journalist, and I've seen you behind the news desk, and I'd seen you in front of the camera, and then all of a sudden to see you on Crime Watch Daily solving cold cases and meeting with people in prisons and going to evidence rooms and really taking your own life in your hands. I mean, I had to wonder, what did it take to evolve? I mean, how did you get from there to there?
Oh, it's never a straight line, right?
Of course.
The journey never is. I think it's because I was an investigative reporter locally, an investigative journalist at the local stations in Los Angeles, and had made a name for myself that way. And so two different national shows called me to see if they could hire me to do very specific work, which is basically going to interview difficult people or people who don't want to be interviewed.
Wow.
So I actually did something for, of all things, Kitchen Nightmares.
Really?
Yeah.
That doesn't sound as scary.
Well, actually, that particular show kind of was. It was a very highly rated show, and Gordon Ramsay walked out, had never like given up on anyone before, and he gave up on these two folks over at Amy's Baking Company. It was a huge, huge show for them.
Okay.
So since Gordon wasn't going to go back into the kitchen to deal with these two, they hired me to do it. And I'm like, really? Because what do I know about cooking?
Like, oh my gosh.
Why would you hire me for a restaurant show? And it was fascinating. And I finally did get them to talk. And the way I did was to basically say to them, hey, I wasn't here. I had nothing to do with it. The show's brought me in to hear your side of it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I did. And they finally sat down and talked, although they were crazy. And then it's kind of the same thing with Crime Watch Daily. They hired me to do an undercover investigation, to do a sting, and then also confront some, predators.
Wow.
And I'm good at doing that, but I think, you know, you could see that persona of me chasing people and being not aggressive, but I like to say assertive in trying to get answers.
Mm-hmm. That is about the craziest theory I've heard. The police say that you took the knife and you stuck it in the wedge of the toboggan and that you basically stabbed yourself in the back.
That was their theory.
Did you?
No. No.
But I think in the middle, I'm just a marshmallow, you know, because I really, I feel for the people who have been wronged.
Well, and I watch you on camera and I can see, I'm almost watching you think through the process. Like, okay, this guy doesn't want to talk to me. What am I going to say next? What am I going to say next? And you just have that ability to slowly, slowly open their listening, which is a gift. I mean, it's not something you can actually learn in school, I think.
I think it takes a lot of time.
Yeah.
I like to think that I am a good listener, and it has to be a conversation.
Mm-hmm.
Because if I'm gonna bark at you, you're not gonna want to talk to me because you're not gonna feel like you've been heard,
you
right?
You don't feel safe either.
No.
Yeah.
And so most of the people, you know, they sit down in the chair freely. They know some of the questions are gonna be hard, some are not. You know, if I'm to the point that I'm chasing you, that's because we've asked you to talk. We've asked for a comment. Things being said about you are very serious. These are serious allegations. You should say something in your defense if you wish to. So I try really hard to make that opportunity,
yeah,
if
available.
You will.
It is. And I think that's, in all fairness, you're not there to accuse anyone. You're always trying to give someone their listening, their time on the air. Let's talk about some of the recent cases you've worked on because they're so interesting. I struggled to think that I could ever do such a thing. I couldn't. So let's talk about some of the ones that actually have been solved, some of the stuff that you've been working on recently.
Yeah, it's been amazing. You know, in the 3 years and the 3 seasons of the show, We've done these cold cases. Mm-hmm. And then by just shedding some attention and shining some light on some of these old cases, you sometimes rattle things. Or someone comes out of the woodwork with some new information. So it really, you know, you should never ignore a cold case. But as a result of doing some of these stories, we've seen some arrests and sometimes bodies being found, which to me has just been stunning, because it's like it's evolving right in front of you. It's shocking. We had one case in Tallahassee. This is like a 17-year-old cold case. The man went duck hunting in the morning and was never seen again.
Wow.
His mother was sure something was wrong. And for those 17 years, his mom would put ads in the local paper. She would stand with homemade posters on the street to remind people, and she would write to the governor, and she would write to anyone who would listen to her. And it was still a cold case, no matter what. And she, in her heart, knew something was wrong. Her son was supposed to go on an anniversary weekend trip with the wife. Mm-hmm. They had a small child. It just didn't seem right. And her gut was right. We go out there, we do the story, and just think about it. So 17 years ago, man disappears, right? Mm-hmm. Then his widow declares him dead, right? Because they found his fishing boat, they found his waders, and people said he had been eaten by alligators. Well, he can't be eaten by alligators in the winter because it's too cold. And if an alligator...
But you have to know that.
Right. And if an alligator is going to kill you, they're not going to devour every bone that you have.
Right, there would be something left
right.
over.
And they had dredged the swamp and had not found anything.
Wow.
Then she, the widow, marries the missing man's best friend. Now, isn't that?
Ding, ding, ding.
Ding, 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 ding. Oh, wait a minute. And he writes insurance policies, and she took out life insurance policies on, dead duck hunter over here. But nothing could ever be proved, right? It was investigated.
Okay.
And then those two started having marital problems. And I think they were feeling like they had a pact that each one was going to kind of hide and save the other one. And mm-hmm. something started fraying at that point. And that's when I started knocking on doors.
Wow.
And just right after that, he kidnapped her. This is all in the record, so I'm not telling, and I'm not using any names right
okay.
now, but it's everything is documented. Mm-hmm. And so he kidnaps her, he allegedly beats her, and in the process of him being arrested, he spills the beans. And he tells the cops everything. He says, now, she's been arrested, it has not gone to court yet, but he claims that the two of them were lovers, and that they plotted to kill the poor husband, so they could be together and take the insurance money.
Oh, my Lord.
So she works at the local university in Tallahassee. She gets arrested in handcuffs, walked, the walk of shame into the patrol car. She's been charged. She denies the whole thing. And then he is still sitting in prison. And the last part of this is we finally find the body of Mike Williams.
Oh,
because
my God.
He told the police where he buried the man. And the body was still enough intact where not only did they do, of course, the DNA identification, but they also knew how he had been murdered. He had been shot.
And this was all because you guys picked up this cold case on Crime Watch Daily.
We picked it up, so did other people, because I believe, it takes an entire community.
Mm-hmm.
But we broadcast it nationally, and no one else had done that to the level that we had, and we stayed on it. And this thing just went bam. And finally, the case
was solved.
Yeah.
And the mother got her truth.
Yes,
yeah.
Though very sad, right? Mm-hmm. The confirmation that your son is dead and that your suspicion was that your daughter-in-law
right.
and your son's best friend likely had something to do with
but
it.
But wouldn't you rather know the truth? So, yeah.
Then think that maybe he just walked off one day.
Mm-hmm. Or maybe he's still out there somewhere.
Exactly.
Something else happened.
And Lauren, with mysterious disappearances,
mm-hmm.
one of the things that's always like left unsaid is, well, what if the person just took off and doesn't want to be found? But that's
it doesn't usually happen.
No.
How do you decide which cases to go after?
Well, at Crime Watch Daily, we have the amazing group of producers, and they go through and they find a bunch of stories. They talk to the families, mm-hmm. and they're always looking for certain criteria. And then we go through a series of pitch meetings to hash it out and talk about it. And the way Crime Watch Daily works is the correspondent is usually like brought in to go, to get briefed, mm-hmm. go in and do all the interviews, mm-hmm. usually on location. And sometimes that means you have to travel to many different states and time zones to get family members or former witnesses or retired cops or investigators. So we try and shoot them in a few days, but those few days don't always happen consecutively. Does that make sense?
It totally does. And I have followed your Facebook posts over the years to you're having coffee in Des Moines and then you're actually having dinner in, you know, Dallas. So I know it doesn't all happen easily. And then you guys would shoot the main pieces in New York City.
We've got a set on the streets of New York. You've got to love this. We literally shoot on Broadway and it's magnificent. So we bring in, and I think we tried to send you some photos of this. So we've got basically a set like this, but with no walls because it's the street. And we're right on a bike path. So, you know, we take up this much space, and every time a biker comes through, it's like, you know, you get thrown off.
Oh my God.
Chris Hansen shoots everything on the street, and then we'll be flown in, you know, to talk about some of our investigations. But I cannot tell you how cold it is on the streets of Manhattan early in the morning. Lauren, you have no idea, and this is the funniest thing. I always say that it's the stuff behind the scenes that is the most interesting. Okay, so there we are. We're literally on the street, and it's freezing. We have made an arrangement with the Bank of America, which is literally right there.
On the corner.
Yes, and they allow us to go in and sit in the lobby of the bank.
Just warm up.
To warm up. And before the bank opens, because we're out there shooting before the bank opens, we just use our ATM card.
Oh my gosh.
And we go into the area where the ATM machine is and just sit there and warm
up. Like you said, it takes a village, right? Everyone has to participate to make the outcome perfect. And I think, you know, that's Crime Watch Daily is one of those shows that when you watch it and you see the fully edited, full production, you don't get any idea of what it took to make all of that happen. And so an insider's view is always so much more interesting.
I think that's why I post so much on Instagram and Facebook and Twitter, because I hope that our viewers get another sense of what's going on. I always like to show what the set is, when we're setting up, all the different places. You know, the weather is insane. Where am I getting my coffee today? I mean, these are real concerns. I go to some places where there is no Starbucks. I mean, there's nothing. And thank God for McDonald's coffee. Did you know you could get espresso shots?
No.
Well,
did not know.
Well, I learned that in Iron Mountain.
Iron Mountain, where
Iron
is that?
Mountain, is that, I think that's Wisconsin or Michigan, because it's, you have to drive through one state to get to the other. And it was a serial killer story, and I should know that. But that it's like in the middle of nowhere.
Oh, my gosh.
Well, unbelievable.
We will have to track you. How can we find you? Where can people see more of what Ana is up to?
It's pretty easy. I always say it's pretty easy to find me. You can find me on my website, AnaGarciaTV.com, or Ana G News, which is the same for Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Okay. Ana G News, one N.
We'll post all that on the screen so our viewers can see it. Ana, thank you so much for joining us and sharing your stories.
Oh, it's so good to see you, Lauren, because she's a friend of mine.
It's been a while.
And I'm so happy to see you.
And I'm grateful that you came in.
And I love your show.
I love
this set. I love everything you do here.
Thank you. Well, we'll have to have you back for more.
Okay.
Thank you. And we'll be right back.